begin the fourth book of the Pentateuch. Okay, we have Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. I've taught through those, and I've taken a break for a few years and decided to get back and try to finish the Pentateuch. And so we're going to do probably Numbers and Deuteronomy through the fall. And just to sort of set up the book of Numbers, just to remember, let me just say, the book of Numbers, I mean, its English name, maybe its Latin or Greek name is the book of Numbers, but if you go into a Hebrew Bible, the name of this book is called In the Wilderness, and that's quite appropriate. As recorded in Exodus, you know, Israel escaped slavery in Egypt, you know, God miraculously set them free, you know, from 400 years of slavery and bondage in Egypt. You know, during those years, they increased in number from 70 people when Jacob brought his little family there to the time Moses pulls out with them and they're heading for that Red Sea crossing. As you'll see tonight, you'll see the justification for it. We're thinking of 2.5 million people. And I was doing some research, and 450 years is plenty of time for a population to go from 70 to that number. It's called exponential growth, and human beings are capable of it. Check out China and India. You don't believe me, but it's actually a very doable number in human reproductive biology. So we should understand that. What I want to show you next is just sort of catch you up on, you know, the book of Exodus is basically the journey from escaping from where they were being held, crossing the Red Sea. Now this map is showing it up here. Part of the Nile River flows, you know, into the Gulf of Suez. But Exodus takes about a year, over a year, and they end up down here at Mount Sinai. Okay? Now they're gonna spend about a year there, and that's the book of Exodus, about a 12-month period. The book of Leviticus is like another month. But the book of Leviticus, God is talking to Moses up on top of Mount Sinai, and he's giving him the law, the beginnings of the law. Now, not all of it, but an awful lot. And he's saying, listen, there's 2.5 million of us out here in the wilderness. We have got to be organized. We have got to have a plan and a way of living and treating one another and dealing with sin when it rears its ugly head. And so in Leviticus, of course, there's a lot about worship. Here's how I want to be worshipped. In Exodus, we have the building of the tabernacle. What a beautiful story in Exodus 28, 29 through 30. It's amazing. God finally has a home built for him. But we're going to be talking about the tabernacle tonight. So a lot goes on there at Mount Sinai. So as we finish Leviticus and come into Numbers, that's right where we are. And now, God is going to change his plans a little bit for what he needs the people to be ready for. He's given them some law, given them some organization, but now it's time for this mass of people to move into the promised land. And what he's going to do is prepare them for what is going to be some military action. And so a lot of what we see tonight has to do with counting how many men are of warrior age, okay, and can serve in the military. And so that's a lot of what Book of Numbers, and a lot of people got worried. Book of Numbers, oh, it's just a big long list of numbers. It is sort of that. But it's called the Book of Numbers because at the very beginning, God numbers all the men of fighting age, from which you can calculate roughly a population estimate. And at the end of Numbers, he does it again. At the beginning of Numbers, he's doing the old generation, the generation that escaped with Moses, right? But in a few chapters, they're going to go up to, you know, Kadesh Barnea, and that's where they send the spies into the promised land, and 10 of the 12 chicken out, except for Joshua and Caleb. That second census is the next generation, because they refused to trust him. We're going to talk tonight. If you have never gotten a grasp of the logistics of the Exodus, you know, being an ex-scientist, I was getting into the numbers and thinking about what this meant. Okay, that to move that many people. And I don't know how often we really think about it. But because they refuse to trust him and go in, only two guys are gonna make it into the promised land that were counted in this first census that we'll read about tonight. That's Joshua and Caleb. All the rest die in the wilderness. And there's another count. And as we're going to see, it's virtually the same number. So that generation is replaced by another generation within 2,000 of the original number. And that's who will eventually go and take the promised land away from all those people that are there. Okay. But it's been a frustrating time for the Lord, right? At Mount Sinai, you know, Israel, you know, was led by Moses' very own brother. He goes up on the mountain to talk to the Lord. He comes down, and here they are worshiping a golden calf. You know how frustrating that's? Aaron, his brother, did that, and he has the lamest excuse. I just told him to throw their gold in the fire, and out came this golden calf, you know? And for some reason, the Lord didn't strike him down right there. I don't know why. But Moses starts getting God's plan for the priests and the nation at large. And so we're up to that point now. And now, Numbers, I said Exodus was a year, Leviticus a month. Numbers covers 38 years.
Wow.
38 years. So this is the entire, really the wandering in the wilderness until God goes back. And so what a difference in time that's covered. And this book tells us what happened during those 38 years. So the wandering, or in the wilderness, a very appropriate name for this book. Now, wilderness was never meant to be Israel's destination. God's intention was to bring them to the promised land of Canaan. The wilderness was only meant to be an avenue to get to the promised land, but it ended up being a place they spent many years. And so the Hebrew word for wilderness is midbar. It means a place for driving flocks. So it's not always completely an arid desert. Now, there are places, I know some of the places where they believe Mount Sinai to be look very arid and rocky, and there's no green anywhere. But wilderness didn't mean just that kind of territory. It could have meant a place where flocks are driven. So it could be grasslands, it could be pasture land, but probably not forests or that sort of thing. But it wasn't automatically this idea of desert. You know, don't think of, you know, Dead Sea, where the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, or Death Valley, or the Sahara Desert. Okay, but on the other hand, not ideal territory to inhabit for a long time. Now, it's also interesting that the wilderness, if you go through Scripture, was on, and what the rabbinic traditions talk about, the wilderness was also supposedly the place of where demons and spirits dwelt. You know, and it's like the Jews were afraid of the wilderness. You know, and I got to thinking today, now a thing we're going to see, I got an amazing picture, but one of the ways God traveled with his people was a cloud by day and this incredible pillar of fire by night. And it just really struck me today more than it ever has. I was thinking about this idea. This is the area. They're in this wilderness where the demons and spirits are thought to have power. And so what's God doing? He's making a super visible presentation of himself with his people. To say, listen, we're in their territory, you have nothing to worry about, but we're heading to the promised land. But every day and every night, you're not going to have to wonder if I'm here with you guys, okay? I think, how cool is that?
You know,
I got an amazing picture I found. I love things that take me to that moment and imagine what it might have been like.
Yeah.
So the first 10 chapters of Numbers only covers 50 days, so the last 25 or so, got to cover some ground fast, right? But that's what we're going to be looking at in the next few days. But it describes how Moses organizes Israel for this march, how to mobilize 2.5 million people. And I think the book of Numbers gives us a big vision. Where's God taking us? Isn't that what all those people are asking about? Where's the Lord taking us? This is nuts. What are we doing out here, you know? What's it going to take to get where he's taking it? What inward qualities does God need to develop in us and demand of us along the way? I pray that we're picking up things like that, because there's great application to this story. Because think, you know, the 2.5 million of the Israelites. Well, you know what? Isn't the Lord very much doing the same thing with the church? Those that are truly the children of Christ, born again. In the same way, he's mobilizing far more than 2.5 million. But you know, how does he want us to be prepared? What does he need us to do? What does he demand of us as he guides the church into the future? You know, so I believe we're going to see some ideas like this. And so the book of Numbers approaches all things via God's way. Not what the Israelites thought best, not even what Moses or Aaron thought best. It's what God says is best. And so when we're in the wilderness, we're often, I think, you know, we're tempted to launch 100 different schemes and plans, aren't we? Sometimes, or maybe before we know the Lord. But it's just always better. Trust the Lord first. Just go there first. So we're going to be reading a lot about God's way. So this chapter one of Numbers is all about a military census of fighting men. And to get into it, I just want to read, let's just read the first three verses. If you're with me, Numbers, chapter 1, verse 1. The Lord spoke to Moses in the wilderness of Sinai, in the tent of meeting, on the first day of the second month, in the second year after they had come out of the land of Egypt. And here's what the Lord said to Moses. Take a census of all the congregation of the people of Israel by clans, by fathers' houses, according to the number of names, comma, you know, every male, head by head. From 20 years old and upward, all in Israel who are able to go to war, you and Aaron shall list them company by company. I think it's kind of interesting. The suggestion is that they're literally writing down the names of these people. They're not just sitting there counting or making scratches at 5, 4, 5, you know, and then adding that up. It seems they're literally taking an accounting. I'll touch on that a little bit later. But that's what we have going on here. God has to take this census in order to prepare his people for battle. And the Jews are about to enter enemy territory. It was imperative that they be organized and prepared to take possession of the promised land. And so it says males 20 years and above. Now, I think there probably needed to be a top end to that. You don't want to say send grandpa into battle, some 80-year-old guy. But, you know, this was like probably 20 to 50, maybe 60. And so, but then in addition to those people would be all the women, children, and older men. So, and the other thing we notice is that this army wasn't made up of volunteers. It said, count and record every able-bodied man 20 years and above. And Israel today, Israel has a non-volunteer army today. You know, they actually, everybody does 2 or 3 years of service in the Israeli army. But in this day, this was absolutely, God expected all of his men to be prepared to fight for them. I just want to say, you know, you and I are in an army as well in one sense, and it's not voluntary either. Now, the moment you gave your life to Christ, you're in basic training to prepare you for spiritual battle. Amen. Listen, the enemy's out there.
Yeah.
Is it just me or is the news, is every week I'm going, well, it can't get worse than this. And there's something else.
Yeah.
You know what the Lord put on my heart? This is me. Well, I was in Texas for a week. It was a real refreshing season. Time for me to with all our family. For some reason, I got in my mind of Jesus saying there will be wars and rumors of wars.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking about that, and I always thought about it in the context only of great armies coming together. But I got to thinking that Jesus saying there's going to be wars and rumors of wars. What's he really saying by that? Isn't that disheartening?
Yes.
When that's what's going on? Isn't that doesn't that steal your peace? Doesn't that cause you to have some anxiety and to be worried? And I thought that. And because, of course, he gives that on the Olivet Discourse, right, the end days. I'm just looking at this. Now, we're not seeing great conventional battles being fought, but the same token, we're hearing just these rumors. And aren't we a little more worried about going to the mall or going on to great public events or whatever? And I still think the odds are, you know, like getting hit by lightning or something. But bottom line, I just think it's a sign of the end of the days to me, that there's just constantly this warning, this stealing of our peace, that we aren't in control. And you know what? There is no fix for it.
No.
That I can see, short of salvation of these people. But I'll tell you what, I mean, I'm not going to, don't get me into a radical jihadist theology thing. But the bottom line, I mean, I sort of see it as sort of like a virus that's now in the human race.
Mm-hmm.
And what viruses do? They attack the very body that sustains them.
Right.
And, I mean, there's other ones. I don't want to get graphic, but, you know, herpes and things like that. Once it's in there, you know. And I'm worried. I mean, I don't know. The Lord could change that. But I'm just saying, we're in crazy days.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think we need to keep our eye that we might hear that trumpet any day as Christ comes to take his church. Amen.
Amen.
We're reminded of 2 Timothy 2:3, endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Endure hardship. Doesn't say enjoy all the booty and the treasures of war. No, enjoy. Endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. And we're soldiers for Christ fighting a real enemy. And the Christian life is not a playground but a battleground. And why? Ephesians 6:12, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Man, it's spiritual war. And many humans, men, are being controlled by dark spirits, you know, demonic spirits. Man, I mean, you have to be demonic to do what these people do. But we need to be prepared for battle, just as the Israelites. Now, by counting all the soldiers, well, we're going to get into that, okay? God wasn't implying that the people trust in their superior forces. It's not what God was doing. But he wasn't going to do it entirely for them either. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to make it possible for you to be successful. But I want you to have some skin in the game. Okay? I want you to be involved. I want you to fight. You're going to have to fight for the land. We're going to have to push out evil forces. They're not just going to wave you in with checkered flags. And so this is the idea he's getting across. They needed to know what their resources were. And we're going to see they were highly organized to be mobilized quickly. You know, we need to know what our resources are as well. A lot of Christians fall spiritually because they never take an honest inventory of where they're at with the Lord and in fighting the spiritual battle we're talking about, right? And so the wise believer makes an honest assessment of their strengths for battle and their weaknesses, especially towards temptation and sin, right? What are our strengths? Ephesians 6, right? The belt of truth, breastplate of righteousness, the shoes of the gospel of peace, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, the sword of the spirit, and praying at all times. You know, that's an assessment of, that's what's on our side, right? What are our weaknesses? Well, I thought of James 1, 14 and 15, but each person is tempted when he's lured and enticed by his own desire. We're often our own worst enemy. Then desire, when it is conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's fully grown, brings forth death. But I just believe as we hunger and thirst for righteousness, God's faithful and just, and if we confess our sins, he'll forgive our sins, right?
Amen.
We need to just know what our strengths are and what our weaknesses are and what the promises of the Lord are. Okay, let's look at verse 4. And there shall be with you a man from each tribe, and each man being the head of the house of his fathers. And these are the names of the men who shall assist you. Now I'm going to, there's a lot of ways, I'm going to be sort of jumping because it's like, paragraph is an exact duplicate sort of sentence after sentence. And so we're just going to jump along because I want to talk about the names. And so it says verse 4, these are the names of the men that shall assist you. This is God speaking to Moses, right? And he says, so it begins in verse 5. It says, from Reuben, Eliezer. Okay? And then what's cool is I was checking out what Chuck Smith wrote about this. He had all these names in Hebrew, what these guys' names mean. Amazing. Okay? This guy's name, Eliezer, is my God is a rock. I got to thinking, I wish we named our kids more like that. I think the Indians sort of still have it right, like Running Bear, Morning Sunrise, you know. I mean, I wish we did, but this guy's name was My God is a Rock. And then it says from Simeon, verse 6, Shelumiel, at peace with God. Isn't that a cool name?
Awesome.
Verse 7, from Judah, Nishan, it's a diviner, one who seeks the Lord, okay, seeks the divine. Verse 8, from Issachar, Nathan. That's the gift of God, you know. Verse 9, from Zebulun, Eliab, my God is Father. And from the sons of Joseph, from Ephraim, Elishama, my God has heard. My God has heard. Aren't these great names?
Sure.
From Manasseh, Gamaliel, my God is a rewarder. Now, how cool. Gamaliel was the teacher of Saul, became Paul, right? Mm-hmm. Gamaliel also defended Peter and John before the Sanhedrin, going, hey, What if they are with God? Maybe we shouldn't fight these guys, you know? Maybe let's just see. If they're not with God, God, nothing will come of it. You know, anyway, Gamaliel, I always like, I never knew his name was My God as a Rewarder. From Benjamin, Abidan, my father is judge. From Dan, Ahiezer, I'm in verse 12 by now, brother of health. Verse 13, from Asher, Pagiel, event of God. 14, from Gad, verse 14, yeah, Eliasaph. God adds, God the adder, the multiplier. That idea, I love that. Verse 15, from Naphtali, Ahira. This is the only weird one. His brother is evil. Okay, not so great a name. I don't know. Sort of like they must have really been mad at his brother when this guy got born. Okay, I don't know. Just always, every time they say your name, it'll be a reminder of the loser your brother is. Okay. Verse 16 says, these were the ones chosen from the congregation, the chiefs of their ancestral tribes, the heads of the clans of Israel. Okay? Well, important guys. Now, in verses, let's just read verses 17 to 20. Moses and Aaron took these men who had been named, and on the first day of the second month, they assembled the whole congregation together who registered themselves by clans, by fathers' houses, according to the number of names, from 20 years old and upward, head by head, as the Lord commanded Moses. So he listed them in the wilderness of Sinai. Okay, so in the next 20 verses or so, we now get a section that the book of Numbers gets its name for, okay? And again, I'm going to be sort of jumping along, but if you look at verse 21, it says, those listed of the tribe of Reuben were 46,500. That's how many fighting age guys there were. Now we're going to see this again and again and again and again. Verse 23, those listed of Simeon, 59,300. Verse 25, those listed of the tribe of Gad, 45,650. 27, those listed of the tribe of Judah, 74,600. That's the largest tribe, by the way. Verse 29, those listed of Issachar, 54,400. Those listed of the tribe of Zebulun, verse 31, 57,400. Verse 33, those listed of the tribe of Ephraim were 40,500. Verse 35, those listed of the tribe of Manasseh were 32,200. That's the smallest tribe, about a third the size of the largest. Okay, verse 37, those listed of the tribe of Benjamin, 35,400. Those listed of the tribe of Dan, in verse 39, 62,700. Those listed of the tribe of Asher, 41,500. Verse 43, those listed of the tribe of Naphtali were 53,400. All those listed were 603,550. Okay? Now, here's the deal. So that's a big number. Based on having 603,000 available soldiers, many people estimate the total population of Israel at this time to between 2 to 2.5 million. I've heard estimates as high as 4 million. Listen, 2 million is about all I can get my arms around, and if it's 2.5, yikes. But it's interesting, at the end of the book of Numbers, 38 years later, they repeat the census, and the total number of soldiers is virtually identical, with about 2,000 less. And it's interesting, you can go through and go, and we may do that, go through and look at the tribes, and they're all different a little bit, but some got bigger and some got smaller. Maybe something to do with them. I don't know. Anyway, that's what happened. There weren't really that many battles at that point. But anyway, the numbers of each tribe changed significantly. I got to thinking, only two of these 600,000 men will cross the River Jordan in 38 years.
Wow.
Okay, same for the 2 million women and children. Or 2.5 million women and children, right? 45 soldiers. And I got to thinking, remember I said all 600,000 are going to die and they're going to be replaced. I'm a scientist, God. That's why I'm loving this book already, I'm telling you. And I just don't, think about it. 45 soldiers and 180 of the people will have to die every day for 38 years. 45 soldiers and 180 people. That's 225 funerals a day for 38 years. That gives your mind some idea of the changeover that God was doing. Isn't that crazy? Because I don't think there was any big 100,000 in one day. Nothing happens like that. It's like God is gradually changing them out. I thought that, I was just thinking about it. Let me amaze you with some facts here about the size of this entourage. At the crossing of the Red Sea, God had to make a huge opening in the body of water here. I love it when Charlton Heston did it, it was about as wide as this room.
Yeah.
They estimated it would take 18 years for 2 million people to walk through an opening that big. Okay?
Wow.
But that's not how it happened in a night. And so for that to happen in a night, it had to be something like 5,000 people abreast and a mass 2 miles long of 5,000 abreast. And I'm trying to think, let me just read what I read. The 2 million Israelites having to cross one night, the opening was only wide enough for them to cross 4 abreast, just 4x4, the line would be 400 miles long.
Wow.
400 miles long. That's not going to work. They did it in a night. Thus, the breach must have allowed a column of people like 5,000. That's like a couple of miles, right? Probably 2 feet per person. I don't know, 10,000 feet, almost 2 miles. Anyway, and then the column would be 2 miles deep. That's a pretty massive undertaking for Moses. Now, some of you guys are managers and supervisors at work. Is this like you going like, what if you woke up? Okay, you got to march 2.5 million people. You can't march 15 anywhere, even for lunch. You know, I can't even imagine how Moses felt. Can you imagine how overwhelming it must have been for him, right? And the thing, you know, it's no wonder he said in the book of Exodus, "Lord, you have the wrong dude for this job. You know, I'm not the guy. What a task!" And yet, when the task is so big and so overwhelming, we have no choice but to trust in the Lord, right? Lean on His understanding because there's no way we can do it you know, I'm not that smart. I love what Moses said in Exodus 14 and verse 13. He said, "Fear not and stand firm and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today." Fear not, stand firm, see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. That's a good word. You know, watch God work today. Stand firm. Don't worry. What a great word. An overwhelming task. But Moses only had to take it a day at a time. A day at a time. You know, despair can cast you down, you know, and it can keep you from standing. Fear will tell you to retreat. Impatience will tell you to do something right now, in a hurry. Presumption will tell you to jump in the Red Sea before it's even, you know, parted. But as God told Israel, and he often tells us to simply stand still and stand firm as he unrolls the plan for your life, to take it a day at a time. You know? So now, in verse 47, we're going to meet the tribe of Levi and their unique role in Israel's spiritual life. Interesting, not service by sword, but service in the sanctuary. Okay. Verse 47. But the Levites were not listed along with them by their ancestral tribe. In other words, no fighting men were counted from the tribe of Levi. Verse 48, for the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Only the tribe of Levi you shall not list, and you shall not take a census of them among the people of Israel. But appoint the Levites over the tabernacle of the testimony." That's the tabernacle, okay? "And over all its furnishings and over all that belongs to it. They are to carry the tabernacle, all its furnishings, and they shall take care of it and shall camp around the tabernacle. When the tabernacle is to set out, the Levites shall take it down. And when the tabernacle is to be pitched, the Levites shall set it up. And if any outsider," so that means anyone other than a Levite, "says, 'Hey, let me help you,' I don't recommend that." It says, "If anyone outsider comes near, he shall be put to death." And that's just, God says that. I mean, his goal wasn't, "Oh, I hope a lot of people are stupid and I can," no, it's just saying, "Do I have your attention? Do I have your attention?" The Levites only are to touch the sacred space, the sacred building. Every wing nut and everything is to be touched only by the tribe of Levi. You know? Verse 52 says, "The people of Israel shall pitch their tents by their companies, each man in his own camp, and each man by his own standard. But the Levites shall camp around the tabernacle of the testimony." I'm going to show you pictures of all this. I'm going to visualize all this for you. So I may be going along, you're going, "Whoa, I'm not getting it." You're going to get it, okay, before we're done, okay? But the Levites shall, verse 53, "But the Levites shall camp around the tabernacle of testimony, so that there may be no wrath on the congregation of the people of Israel. And the Levites shall keep guard over the tabernacle of testimony. Thus did the people of Israel. They did according to all that the Lord commanded Moses." Okay? Now we're going to be reminded again in chapter 2 that God is a God of organization and not chaos, not randomness, "Oh, it'll work out" kind of guy. No. God plans every little detail of the people. Chapter 2. "The Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, saying, 'The people of Israel shall camp each by his own standard with the banners of their fathers' houses. They shall camp facing the tent of meeting on every side.'" Okay? Now God is going to lay out how he wanted the tribes to arrange themselves around the tabernacle. Wasn't supposed to be, "Oh, you know, anywhere out there, if you can be near people you kind of know, that's cool. As long as you can see my big pillar of fire at night." He's got specifically where he wants them to be, right? Apparently for 13 months, the people camped sort of in any way, in any groupings they wanted. I'd imagine the tribe sort of grouped together, right? But God says no longer. This is the layout I demand. And of course, the centerpiece of the whole thing was the tabernacle, where God himself dwelled. And so I think God was demonstrating as to his people, making clear the point of the importance of putting him first, not what you want, what God wants. The center of my life needs to be the Lord, not all the white noise of life around me. There's a million ways we all can live, right?
Yeah.
There's a million things you can put your focus on in the morning when you wake up. But the God saying is, when you open your eyes and open the front door, you wanted them seeing either the pillar of smoke or the column of fire, right?
Mm-hmm.
Every single one of them. And that's what we see happening here. And I think that's a good word for our lives too, isn't it?
Yeah.
Jesus said in Matthew 6:33, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these other things will be added to you." And so just as the presence of the Lord was in the holiest of holies in the center of the camp, so God wants to be in the center of our hearts. He does dwell there. I mean, the Holy Spirit dwells there. In fact, in John it says, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit dwell in our heart. They come, they want to abide with us. So it was a living illustration day after day of where he wanted to be in their lives. So the tabernacle, the center of everything. Next, verse 3, chapter 2. Those to camp on the east side toward the sunrise shall be the standard of the camp of Judah. And I'll just say, it's not... Okay, the standard would be like a big flag or a banner. Okay, that's what it's saying. The rabbinic, we don't have much detail about that in the actual Pentateuch, but in the rabbinic tradition says each tribe had a color that was probably symbolic of their clans, okay? And then they had a symbol. And again, the rabbinic tradition, and this one actually is supported by scriptures, that Judah's would be a lion. So we imagine, I don't know, maybe a blue, giant blue banner with a big lion. And then each of these standards covered three tribes. But it was called by the head tribe of that three. Each threesome had a head tribe, okay? So the standard of the camp of Judah was led by that tribe. And so verse 3 goes on. Okay, the standard of the camp of Judah, by their companies, the chief of the people of Judah being Nahshon, the son of Amminadab. We just went through what his name meant in Hebrew a few minutes ago. His company listed as being 74,600. Those to camp next to him shall be the tribe of Issachar. Okay, so we're going to have the Judah. Then next to Judah, facing the tabernacle, is going to be Issachar. If you don't mind, jump down to verse 7. Then the tribe of Zebulun, okay, will be next to those guys. Verse 9, all those listed of the camp of Judah by their companies were 186,400. You add up their three armies of guys, 186,000. All graphics for all this help you understand a little bit. So the camp of Judah will always be the lead contingent when on the march. Okay, we're going to see in chapter 10, it says they go on their first march, and it shows how this entire mass of people moves out in order. So it's very useful. Now, so 186,000 in the camp of Judah. The population of Melbourne O'Galley is 80,000. Pompeii, 105,000. So just the camp of Judah is like Melbourne, O'Galley, Pompeii. That many people, all living in tents.
In the wilderness. All their supplies and all the rest of the stuff.
Well, we'll get there. The logistics are awesome. But remember, God's involved. This isn't a work of men entirely. God's in it. Verse 10. On the south side, so it goes from east to south, sort of going clockwise around the tabernacle, if you will. On the south side shall be the standard of the camp of Reuben. We believe the rabbinic tradition says their symbol was a man's face. Okay? Verse 12 says, and those to camp next to him shall be the tribe of Simeon, then the tribe of Gad next to them. So we have Reuben, Simeon, and Gad. Combined, in verse 16, it says their companies was 151,000. So this third big encampment is just a little bit smaller than what I just described to you, right? They will set out second. God is into detail. He's into organization. Verse 17 says, then the tent of meeting shall set out. So it's going to follow those guys, right? With the camp of the Levites in the midst of the camps as they camp. So they shall set out each in position standard by standard. Verse 18, on the west side, so now we're going around to sort of the back side, the west side, be the standard of the camp of Ephraim. It's either an ox or a calf. It's thought to maybe be the symbol that would have been on their standard, but by their companies, okay? And next to Ephraim will be the tribe of Manasseh. We see that in verse 20. And verse 22 says the tribe of Benjamin would be then next to them. And all those listed in the camp of Ephraim by their companies were 108,100. So that's the smallest group, okay? And they'll set out third on the march. Verse 25, on the north side, this will be the last one, shall be the standard of the camp of Dan. And we think that's an eagle, okay? Verse 27 goes on, and those to camp next to him shall be the tribe of Asher. Verse 29 says, then the tribe of Naphtali. And then of those three tribes, verse 31 says, all those listed in the camp of Dan were 157,600. They shall set out last, standard by standard. Verse 32. These are the people of Israel as listed by their fathers' houses. All those listed in the camps by their companies were 603,550. But the Levites were not listed among the people of Israel as the Lord commanded Moses. Thus did the people of Israel according to all that the Lord commanded Moses. So they camped by their standards. And so they set out, each one in his clan, according to his father's house. I want to take a few minutes here. Let's try to get a picture of some of this stuff. There will be a census of the Levites coming up, by the way, but they're not included. It's because they weren't fighting men. Okay? I just want to show you a couple of things. If you didn't know, this is a life-size record, taking the measurements out of the book of Exodus of what the tabernacle would have been. That white thing around there, I use this, I know it's not, I mean, it's not, there's cars and stuff in it. But I wanted there to be cars and stuff in it to give you a sense of scale. So the tabernacle was not some monstrous thing, but that's about the size of it. So you got the great altar in front, the laver, the washing, and then you go into the holy place would be the first part, and the back third would be the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was and where God actually resided. Okay? But you can see it's not gigantic, but that was called the court, that outer band. Now, in the Bible, each of those poles were covered in gold. Okay? I mean, in fact, a lot of the stuff was covered in gold, so it was really heavy. Okay? But anyway, this gives you an idea. That's what's in the middle of the camp. Now, here's what we just read about, if you want to visualize it a little bit. So here's the tabernacle. The east end of the tabernacle is the only place of entrance. That's the one and only door, okay? And it says that Moses and the priests, the Levites, lived, okay? They camped right in front of that to sort of protect the tabernacle from people that should not be going in, whatever, okay? They're there. But here we have Judah, Issachar, and Zebulun, the camp of Judah. They would march out first in this place. The next was Gad, Simeon, and Reuben. They would pour in behind them. Then would come the Gershon and Merari carried the parts of the tabernacle. Okay? Kohath was responsible for the Ark of the Covenant itself. Okay? And then they would go in the middle. Then these guys, the camp of Ephraim, would follow in line. And last, the camp of Dan. And the way it worked out is that the two biggest armies were at the front and the back. Okay? And then the smaller, the next two, were about equal in size as well. So does that, I hope that gives you some idea. Now we're gonna look at this again because we're gonna talk about the camp of the Levites. That's who these guys are. And the Lord has just as much detail for them. This is kind of cool. This is a graphic where each arm is proportional to the number of troops that were counted. Okay, in the thing. Okay? And so now, to match my map, we'd have to spin it around that way. But here's it. Here's Judah at the bottom at the east. Forms, that's a histogram, as we call that in statistics. That's the three tribes there. Then we have Reuben, image of a man, would be that arm. I said that Ephraim was the smallest, 108, you know, that's the top part. And, there, and then the other wing there, the camp with Dan, tabernacle in the center, opening phase, and then we have the three tribes. I just thought that's kind of cool. And proportionally, cool. Now they say, we will spend eternity scratching the surface of all that God wants to reveal from the Bible. You know, all the symbology and things that are hard to see, but He thinks of everything.
How much space would one of those wings take? You've done a lot of figuring.
I'm not done yet either. How much? Be patient. Here's the picture I found. Isn't that cool?
I love it.
Can you imagine sunset in the camp at Mount Sinai?
Yeah.
I just looked at that. I just went, how cool would that be? And every night you had that. And that's God. That's God.
Awesome.
Being there. I just thought, what a cool image. And you start to get a sense of the vastness of this place, you know? And I just love that picture, so if you don't mind me showing you that one. Okay.
Wow.
This is a refugee camp today. In Syria.
Wow.
Syrians in Jordan. It's called Za'atari. It's thought to be the largest tent city in the world. This is obviously a helicopter. That's just 80,000 people.
Wow.
80,000 people. So 2.5 million.
Wow.
2.5 million. I estimate, is that a mile square maybe?
Okay.
It would take 25 camps like that to be 2.5 million. 25 square miles.
We couldn't see the back of it.
I know. I mean, it's like, so that would be just Simeon, you know, or Judah, and then the tabernacle would be here. Then there'd be another one going.
Wow.
I mean, isn't it crazy when you start trying to put, try to understand what God is doing? So anyway, 2 million people would take 25 of these. They were saying that they needed about 11 million gallons of water a day.
Oh, wow.
So that's like a river.
Wow.
That's like a river. But rivers flow at millions of gallons an hour or something. So, I mean, but they were talking about how many tank cars on a rail on a train. And it was something like 1,800 tank cars, you know, 40-mile-long train every day. 4 million pounds of food a day.
Okay. Wow.
But that, we know that that was manna and herbs, right?
Yeah.
So, anyway, I just wanted you to start to get an idea of that. And then we had that picture of evening in the camp, but it was, the logistics are wow. And I was thinking as I was driving here tonight, Lord, why wouldn't it have been easier to take 70 people to the promised land and let them turn into 2 million there? Problem is, people in the promised land didn't want the Jews there and never would have let them grow and honor the Lord because they were pagan, demon-worshipping people. So God had to show up with an irresistible shock and awe. You know,
yeah.
He had to show up with a force that no one's going to say, well, we don't feel like letting you guys in. Really?
Yeah, really.
Put it behind me, 2.5 million people. Really? If they just all had one rock, they all threw it at once, they could defeat any army in the world, right?
Imagine
2 million rocks. I don't care how many spirits. But I say that God needed to do something that was irresistible.
Yeah.
To take over. Now, we know they didn't perfectly remove all the people, but you know what? Nobody stopped them either. And then just look at these numbers of each of the tribes, 50,000, 80,000, whatever. Those guys were each given a parcel of land in the promised land, right? And that's, wow, that establishes you when you've got that many people. So I'm just thinking, I don't think like God, but I just to me, it does make sense to do it that way, right? I mean, so anyway. So some observations from chapter 2. God is a God of order. Do you agree?
Yeah,
you agree?
Yes.
Nothing is accomplished in God's kingdom without order and organization. You know, it may not seem sometimes that that's the case to us, but behind the scenes, God is moving with the utmost of order and organization, whether we can see it or not. He's got, it's sort of like what he's doing in the church today. To us, it looks like all these denominations and Calvary Chapel and Baptist.
Yeah.
You know what? God's behind there, and it's all moving inexorably forward to his desired conclusion, right?
Mm-hmm.
Have you also noticed that as you follow Christ more and more, your life becomes more ordered
and
less chaotic?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Isn't that true?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I was thinking about that today and just what a simple truth that was, because I mean, just, all this stuff that excites me, I don't know. And then just the Lord sort of takes over your life, and I just sort of, wow, I just want to obey the Lord. It hasn't taken away anything that he hasn't replaced with greater joy and peace and enjoyment. And it's just sort of, God has my back, man. I love
it.
You know? Secondly, God orders things according to his wisdom and not ours. Okay? You know, our resistance to God's order and organization is almost always the product of wanting to do things our own way, right?
Yeah.
I don't see it, Lord. I think I have a better idea. Really?
Wrong.
He spoke creation into existence, and you have a better idea, okay?
Mm-hmm.
you know, your slaves don't have to think about order. It's forced on them. But free men and women, God teaches us we need to obey him and let him order our life, you know. A third thing, everything was positioned in relation to the presence of God, wasn't it, in the tabernacle? It's hard to underestimate the trouble we get into in our walk with God because we position and measure ourselves in reference to other people. How often do we do that? Am I going to be in good standing with that group of people? Are they going to think I'm a dope for becoming a Christ follower? Or whatever. No. Am I pleasing God? Yay. Okay. Who cares? It really doesn't matter at the end of the day what they think.
Right.
My focus is on the Lord, right?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
I like now again Isaiah 26:4. The Lord keeps him in perfect peace. His mind stayed on him. A powerful verse. I mean, that speaks to today too, isn't it? I mean, we could be going, getting kind of crazy, but you know what? We're the children of God. And God desires to keep us in perfect peace. As our mind is stayed on him, the world will have to take care of itself, but we keep our eyes on the cross, right? Anyway, the fourth thing I might mention is the tribes of Israel camped around four banners, which were said to be the lion, the man, a calf, and an eagle. It's interesting, in Revelation, there's four angels around the throne of God, and Revelation 4:7 says the first living creature was like a lion, the second living creature like a calf, the third living creature had a face like a man, and the fourth living creature was like a flying eagle. And so the rabbinic traditions began way before John wrote the book of Revelation, you know. But this is what he saw as God revealed the throne room of God to him. What an interesting, no coincidences, right? God's order is never arbitrary or just made up on a whim. It's after his heavenly pattern. And we need to always accept God's order and organization, even when we don't understand it. And now we're going to blast through chapter 3. So having numbered those fit for war, now God numbers those fit for holy service. Holy service. Chapter 3, verse 1. These are the generations of Aaron and Moses at the time when the Lord spoke with Moses on Mount Sinai. These are the names of the sons of Aaron. Nadab, the firstborn, and Abihu, Eleazar, and Ithamar. These are the names of the sons of Aaron, the anointed priests whom he ordained to serve as priests. Okay? But Nadab and Abihu died before the Lord when they offered unauthorized, your Bible may say strange or profane or unholy, fire before the Lord in the wilderness of Sinai. They had no children. So Eleazar and Ithamar served as priests in the lifetime of Aaron, their father. Okay? So since only Aaron, now here's the deal. Only descendants of Aaron. Okay, Aaron is a Levite. Aaron's in the tribe of Levi.
Mm-hmm.
All the priests, all of Aaron's children, all of his progeny were Levites. But God said, only the descendants of Aaron shall be priests. So here's the deal. All priests were Levites, but not all Levites were priests, because not all Levites were from Aaron's family.
Right.
There would have been many other men. There were patriarchs of that tribe. And so, but all of the Levites were called to serve the Lord, but only the priests were allowed to go into that tabernacle, okay, and touch the things of the Lord and prepare the sacrifices and put out the showbread and stoke the fire and sacrifice the animals and burn the offerings. You get the idea, right? So that's the deal. Now, Nadab and Abihu were the sons of Aaron, right? They were Levites, but they did something, and there, boy, there's so much speculation on what they did. Strange fire. It's hard to know exactly what that's getting at. But I want to make another point before I jump on that. Why the Levites? Why the Levites? That'll remind myself. I can't keep all this stuff in my head. But it's interesting. Recall in Exodus that when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the tablets and the people were worshiping the golden calf, he got really angry. And he said, who is on my side? And the only tribe that stepped up is as the Levites stepped up. The only ones. All the other 11. Oh, I don't know, man. We're at a pretty good party going down here. You're kind of a buzzkill, Moses. You know what I'm saying? But the Levites come up and they go, we're on your side, Moses, because I'm just up speaking with God. Okay? And they actually go and they slay, I think, 3,000. People in the camp who were probably the worst of the worst ringleaders of this blasphemous thing of the golden calf. They slayed them, yeah. And so that's why the Levites are special in God's eyes. And so, you know, God needed the entire tribe of Levi to do everything he desired to be done. So anyway, I just want to make that point clear. Now, it's interesting that in our culture, so it's like everybody's related to each other, though, isn't it? It's like Aaron, all the sons. It's funny, in our culture, we have a problem with nepotism. Right? But God didn't have a problem with nepotism. You're going to be the priest. We want all your sons to be the priests, and their sons, and you know, and Moses, you know, your son, and all their sons that they have. You know, God doesn't see it that way, right? He sees it as good when families serve the Lord together. That's why I think nepotism in the church is awesome. You know, family serving God together. What a beautiful picture, right? Now, what did these guys do, the two brothers that died? Maybe they put the wrong kind of incense. Not there was a specific incense that was only to be burned in the tabernacle. Maybe they did the wrong thing. They might have sought to go into the most holy place with their incense. Only the high priest was allowed to go in there. There's a later on, just a couple of verses from them dying, there's a warning for priests, they're prohibiting priests from drinking wine or fermented drink when they're serving the Lord. Okay, so maybe they were drunk in doing this, and so that made it a profane thing to not mentally be connected with what you're doing, because what they were doing was important to the Lord, right? But anyway, they acted contrary to the Lord's will, and their immediate judgment by God was pretty dramatic. It's called being cut off from your people, but it's like being cut off from breathing, okay? And I think the moral of the story is summarized by Moses, and that those that have the privilege of being nearest to God must bear a special responsibility to magnify His holiness in the way you do everything. And you know, certainly as a church here, I desire that everything we do on a Sunday morning or even here on a Wednesday night, I want to honor the Lord in what we do. I love that Calvary is sort of a church where you come as you are, be who you are, no masks necessary, you know, be comfortable, but serve the heart of the Lord with great motives from your heart. Yeah. That's what blesses Him. That's what brings a smile to His face, right? So we're always trying to do that. Now, it's interesting. The disposal of their bodies, these two sons, is telling. It says, in obedience to Moses' command, two cousins of Aaron carried the bodies of Aaron's two sons outside the camp, discarding them like the useless parts of sacrificial animals. There were parts of animals they sacrificed. They didn't burn them. They just went out in the trash heap. These guys weren't sort of buried in a really sad state funeral or something. But it says, take them out and just throw them outside the camp. And that's where Jesus was crucified, outside the city walls, right? For those who are the desecration sort of thing. But the point of being is that that was, well, it's just a similar thing with Aaron's sons here, and that they really had sinned greatly. Unlike Jesus, who was innocent, but the point is the same. Verse 5, some of their duties. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, bring the tribe of Levi near and set them before Aaron the priest, that they may minister to him. Okay, they shall keep guard over him and over the whole congregation before the tent of meeting as they minister the tabernacle. Verse 8, they shall guard all the furnishings of the tent of meeting and keep guard over the people of Israel as they minister the tabernacle. Well, like I said, a lot of gold in that place. And not everybody in the contingent, that 2.5 million, not everybody was a Jew. There were some non-Jews that were allowed, servants, what have you, that were allowed to come along. You know, they might not have the same, you know, they might, wow, check out that little gold fork they, you know, these guys were guarding all that stuff, okay? That was part of what they were doing. Verse 9. And you shall give the Levites to Aaron and his sons. They are wholly given to him from among the people of Israel. You shall appoint Aaron and his sons, and they shall guard their priesthood. But if any outsider comes near, he shall be put to death. So the Levites were not doing the work of the priest. And they're sort of being told, don't be tempted to. We're giving you access, but you don't have to touch anything. We're doing, stay within your duty, okay? Or else even a Levite could conceivably be put to death. But again, we see God's order and organization. Verse 11, the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, behold, I have taken the Levites from among the people of Israel instead of every firstborn who opens the womb among the people of Israel. The Levites shall be mine, for all the firstborn are mine. On the day that I struck down all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, that was the Passover back in Egypt, right? Night of the Passover, I consecrated for my own all the firstborn of Israel. Both of man and of beast, they shall be mine. I am the Lord. Okay? But God's doing, so he's saying, you can go back in Exodus, and it says that all of those firstborn that were spared on the night of the Passover, God said, they're mine. They are now consecrated unto me, especially. But at this point, he's going, I'm going to make a transfer now. Rather than all of those, the entire tribe of Levi is now going to take their place ceremonially or symbolically from all the firstborn of the non-Levitical tribes. Okay, this holy priesthood, the firstborn of those, is going to take their place. That's what's being said here. And now it says, the sons of Levi will be counted from the age of a month old and up. Why a month old? Well, the thought is that maybe in that day, until a baby reached the age of a month, it was a little dicey, more so. They wanted a more angle, but by a month, you're probably going to make it. I don't know what infant mortality was like in those days, but that's the deal. Not 20 years, but a month and up. Verse 14, the Lord spoke to Moses in the wilderness, saying, list the sons of Levi by father's houses, by clans, every male from a month old and upward you shall list. So Moses listed them according to the word of the Lord as he had commanded. And these were the sons of Levi by their names, Gershon, Kohath, and Merari. These are the names of the sons of Gershon by their clans, Libni and Shimei, the sons of Kohath by their clans, Amram, Izhar, Hebron, and Uziel. And the sons of Merari were by their clans, Mali and Mushi. That's not fair. These are the clans of the Levites by their father's house. And we're going to see that the clans, I think rather than try to pull that all up again, you remember I showed you the clans of the Levites were on four sides of the tabernacle, and that's all that's being described here. They had specific places they were only ever to camp their particular tribes. Okay, verse 21. To Gershon belonged the clan of the Libnites and the clan of the Shemites. These were the clans of the Gershonites. Their listing, according to the number of all the males from a month old and upward, was 7,500. Okay, the clan of the Gershonites were to camp behind the tabernacle on the west. Okay? Verse 25, the guard duty of the sons of Gershon in the tent of meeting involved the tabernacle, the tent with its covering, the screen for the entrance of the tent of meeting, the hangings of the court, the screen for the door of the court that is around the tabernacle and the altar, and its cords, all the service connected with these. Now, not only were they guarding that, when the tabernacle was to be struck down for a move, they were responsible for all of that. We call it the soft stuff. Sort of pretty much everything that was fabric or soft, they had to carry. They were involved folding that up and putting that on wagons, and that was their gig. Okay, and there were 7,500 of them to do that. I suspect they worked in shifts because, again, the tabernacle wasn't all that giant or anything, but they all had a way of being a part of that. Verse 27, to Kohath belonged the clan of the Amramites, the clan of the Israelites, and the clan of the Hebronites. And the Uzzielites, these are the clans of the Kohathites, according to the number of all the males from a month old and upward. There were 8,600 of these guys keeping guard over the sanctuary. And the clans of the sons of Kohath were to camp on the south side of the tabernacle, with Eliphaz, the son of Uzziel, as chief of the father's house of the clans. 31, their guard duty involved, now here they had different guards, they were over different stuff. The ark itself, the table, the lampstand, the altars, the vessels of the sanctuary, of which the priests minister, and the screen, all the service connected with these. This might have been the screen into the Holy of Holies. That might have been the only fabric-y thing that the other guys didn't have. But that screen, they said, was like, it might have been like that thick. It was almost like a wall, a foldable wall. But it was an amazing bit of weaving, at any rate. 32, Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the priest, was to be chief over the chiefs of the Levites. Verse 33, to Merari belonged the clan of the Mahlites and the Mushites. I think it'd be a Mushite. Anyway, these were the clans of Merari. Verse 34, their listing, according to the number of all the males from a month old and upward, was 6,200. And the chief of the father's house of the clans of Merari was Uriel. And they were to camp on the north side. And here it is, entering 36, the appointed guard duty of the sons of Merari involved the frames of the tabernacle, the bars, the pillars, the bases, all their accessories, all the service connected with these, also the pillars around the court, their bases, and pegs and cords. Those who were to camp before the tabernacle on the east, before the tent of meeting toward the sunrise, were Moses and Aaron. Those who are to camp in the east were Moses and Aaron and his sons. So they camped in front of the opening to the tabernacle, guarding the sanctuary itself. I think how interesting it is that the east entrance to the tabernacle is when we consider, you know, the east is it because in Ezekiel there's a prophecy of the Messiah coming, which would be Christ's second coming. It says he's going to stand on the Mount of Olives and enter from the east into the holy city. And how interesting that that's the key location way back in this time, the east entrance to that. Anyone that came near, verse 38, the end of it, was to be put to death. All those listed among the Levites by clans and by the males from month old were 22,000. Okay, so all those four guys, you count them all, 22,000 of these guys. Okay, I'm going to tell you something right now. If you're an accountant and you were adding things up as we went, it actually was 22,300, but we think that's a scribal error, okay? And one of the tribes, if I had my thing, I could have shown you, it says 8,600, and it should have been 8,300, because in Hebrew, 3 and 6, it's virtually an identical scribble, and a scribe could have made an error, because we're going to see, when God does the math here, the number has to be 22,000. Not 22,300. So all I say is, if you do some research, you'll see that. But that's the rationale that might cause it. Verse 40 says, the Lord said to Moses, list all the firstborn males. So we just saw that. 41, you shall take the Levites for me. I am the Lord. Instead of all the firstborn firstborn among the people of Israel, and the cattle of the Levites instead of all the firstborn among the cattle of the people of Israel. So he's making the shift. Now my consecrated people are going to be the Levites, not all the people. Verse 42, so Moses listed all the firstborn among the people of Israel, as the Lord commanded him. All of their firstborn males added up to 22,273. Okay? So, that's 273 more than should be the right, than the right number for all the tribe of Levi, right? 273. Now, and they're thinking that 22,000 firstborn among 2.5 million can't be all the firstborn from the day of Passover. It's thought to be just, that's how many got born in the 13 months since they crossed the Red Sea and got to Sinai.
Right.
And so that's what he's looking at. That group that have been born on the Exodus is 22,273. Okay, 44 says, take the Levites instead of the firstborn. The Levites shall be mine, and as the redemption price for the 200. So here God, this is God speaking. He says, for the 273 over, you see why I have to believe that's a scribal error? Because God's just said the math is 22,000 even, 22,273. This is just sort of hermeneutics of understanding Scripture. God adds really good, okay? He's saying that the number should be 22,000 even. Just saying. More detail than you want this late at night. Okay, verse 46. And as the redemption price for the 273 of the firstborn of the people over and above the number of the Levites. So there's not enough Levites to take the place of all of the people's children. So the people are going to have to pay a redemption price for 273 children. And back in Leviticus, there was actually a value given to that. It was 5 temple shekels. Okay? Okay, and it says in verse 37, you shall take 5 shekels per head. Okay, and by the way, a shekel, or 5 shekels was about a year of salary for a herdsman. Was not an insubstantial amount of money. So you shall take them according to the shekel of the sanctuary and give the money to Aaron and his sons as the redemption price for those who are over that number. Now, there's 22,273. Which parents had to pay that? I mean, I think mine are included in the 22,000. I don't think, I think they probably divided that up among the 12 tribes, whatever that, and each tribe had a, I mean, that would be, God would be equitable in that. Because I don't see how you decide which were the 273 over. That doesn't make any sense, I don't know. But anyway, that was the deal. Verse 49, so Moses took the redemption money from those who were over and above those redeemed by the Levites. From the firstborn of the people of Israel, he took the money. There are 1,365 shekels. Verse 51, Moses gave the redemption money to Aaron and his sons according to the word of the Lord, and the Lord, as the Lord commanded Moses. And you're going to find that's just what Moses always did. He did what the Lord commanded him. That's why God loved him. That's why he's called the meekest man among all men. That means he's controlled and owned by the Lord. That's what meekness means. Meekness is not weakness. Meekness is being mastered by God. Okay. Wrap up with a few things. So God, numbers, organization. Why was this count? Why were these censuses so important? I'm just going to say four possible ways. First of all, verification. What did God promise Abraham about children when he was 100 years old and no kids? You will be the father of many, many. Okay? He'd be the father of a great nation. Yeah. The first count was just 2 old barren people. Okay? The last count of the Israelites we had before the book of Numbers was 70 of them went into Egypt. That was the next count. Well, God's verifying, I keep my word. And so what he's done with this census, he's drawn a line in the sand. The number now, just fighting them, 603,000. Okay, do the rest of the math, 2 million, Abraham. On the spiritual pedigree, the last thing, organization. You know, we've been called to be soldiers in an army. We're involved in a war, so there has to be order. Have you ever seen an army that wasn't organized? You know, anyone serious about serving God, who's not a part of any local church, who's not in submission to anybody, who's not linked with anyone, not accountable to anybody, sooner or later, they're going to be a casualty of war. And there's a great blessing in being organized and a part of a healthy body whose focus is on the Lord God and His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. You know, God is not into Lone Ranger mentality. You bump into those people, you know, but the story's not written. You know, the Lord may very, you know, brings them back into fellowship, give them some time. Maybe they need a season to unscramble things a little bit, right? But we need to be part of the army of God. Know your pedigree. Is it in Jesus Christ? It's the only thing that counts. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, we